So let's go back now to our main activity as we continue on adding our extra functionality for the button to do something when we click it. And we want to have a look at what this R class is all about. We talked a little bit about what it was and how it's a resource that's created automatically by Android Studio. But let's have a look at the actual class itself just to see what it looks like. So I'm just showing you all of this to explain what's going on here. And you wouldn't normally edit this class R, and you certainly shouldn't go making any changes to it. So if we open it up, what we need to do to see it, we can't see it in our normal Android view. We need to come up here and go into Project View to even see the file. Once we do that, we're going to open this up. Then we come down here into App. Then we go into Build, Generated, Source, R. Then we come down here to Debug. Then you should have your package name here. In my case, it's com.timberchowker.buttonclickcounter. I'm going to open that. And finally, we get to the class R. I'm going to double click that to open it. Now, this is the resources class that is created automatically by Android Studio every time we make a change somewhere that involves using an ID. So once again, there's no reason for you to edit this file. And in actual fact, you can see that there's a warning at the top here saying that files under the build folder are generated and should not be edited. What that means is that every time you recompile or rebuild your application, these files are recreated. So if it did make a change in here, the change would be lost. But that's okay in this case because it is just a build file and Android Studio is responsible for keeping that updated. So as I scroll through it now, you can see that it contains all sorts of things that probably don't make a lot of sense to you. There's a lot of guff in there and all these weird numbers. I'm going to do a search for class ID. Class ID. And I held down the command and press F. But you can also come up here, click on Find, and you can do the equivalent thing. I can't select that now because I've already got it open. But that's how you find, and then you just type in what you want to search for, and it will automatically find it. So it's found this class ID, and you can see this file is quite long, already up to about 1900 lines here. And scrolling down a little bit, you can see the button here. Edit text, and also text view as well. So these are the IDs that internally Android Studio is associating with the edit text that we defined in our layout. Because each ID needs to be unique, but fortunately from our point of view, we just type in something that makes sense to us, and Android creates some sort of complicated number that it uses to make it unique internally. So most of these aren't used and they won't appear in the final compiled version of the app, but you can see that we've got the ones that we've defined and they are showing in there. And obviously if we had more widgets used on your layout, or more layouts for that matter, then they would all be appearing in here. So these are actually in a class called ID, which is inside another class called R, which is why closing this and switching back to main activity, while we use r.id.editText. So it's the main class R, the class within a class.id, and then the actual ID that we're using. I know I've digressed a bit there, but we're actually trying to connect the button up to some code, so perhaps we should get back to that now. So we've got some references to the widgets. Let's have a go at connecting this up. So if you recall, I said that the Android framework takes care of watching for user input, and it notifies us when something interesting happens. Now, the way it notifies our code of events that have happened is by calling special methods that we write called callbacks. So, for example, when a button's clicked, the Android framework will call an onClick method if we've written one and we've told Android that it's attached to the particular button that was clicked. Now, we can't just go creating just any old method and call it onClick and expect Java to be able to cope, though. Java is a very strongly typed language. And that means that you have to provide exactly the right kind of object or method that something expects. Now, the way that that's defined in Java is using interfaces. And Android uses an interface called onClickListener to make sure that only the correct type of object is attached to the button to respond to these clicks. So once again, I'm going to type the code in, then explain what it's doing. I'm going to come down here after our text view, and I'm going to type in private int num times clicked equals zero, like so. Then I'm going to come down to the code under the text view, so under the last line of code we've typed in the onCreate method. I'm going to type in some more code now. And the code is going to be view.onClickListener. Being absolutely sure you've got the same case typed as I'm typing, I'm going to press enter there. Notice when I did that, we got an import appear up on the screen on line 5. And I'm going to continue typing by pressing space. Then I'm going to type in our onClickListener equals new. I'm going to type view. Now notice what happened when I typed V. I've got this special option showing as a menu here. We've got these left brace and right brace there. So what that means is that's going to be special code that Android Studio will create for us if we select that. I can either double click it or I could have pressed enter. So if I double click it, notice how it created this code for us automatically. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to type in this code and then we're going to talk about it. And here I'm going to type num times clicked equals num. And notice when I'm typing how Android Studio is trying to find variable names for us and try and shortcut the amount of code we have to type. If that's the right thing, as I've mentioned before, press enter, and it automatically adds that for us without us having to type it all. I can type string result equals backslash n the button got tapped num times clicked plus time. And text view dot append result. I need to come down here where this is flagging a little error, the little red error there, and press a semicolon to make that valid. All right, so what does all that mean that I've typed in? Well, firstly, on line 15, I created an int variable called number of times clicked or num times clicked, and that's going to keep track of how many times we click the button in our application. Now, in our onCreate method, starting with this code on line 25, I created a new object of type onClickListener. Now, actually, it's view.onClickListener, as you can see on the screen there, because the actual interface is defined in the view class. Now, because all widgets extend view, they'll all know about this interface, so actually we can tap things other than buttons, and I'm sure if you've run an application in the past, there's been many things that you've been able to tap on the screen other than buttons and get some sort of response from an Android application. So this is quite a simple method. All it actually does down here in the onClick method, starting on line 28, is going to increase the value of num times clicked by 1, and then it's going to add a message to our text view widget. Now remember that we've now got a reference to the widget in the text view field. So what we're doing here is text view, we're actually calling an append method to add a line of text to that text view. And you'll see it when we run this application appear on the screen. Now this slash n over here on line 29, backslash n, if you put that at the start of the message, it causes a new line to be started before the message is displayed. Now we're doing it that way so that each message starts on a new line. Without that, the message would display one after the other, wrapping when they reach the edge of the text view. So you can use the special characters like slash n in strings whenever you want to insert a line break, although it's more usual to put it at the end of a message rather than the beginning. Now the last thing we need to do then is come down here and on line 34, what I'm going to do is type in button.setOnClickListener. Our onClickListener. So we're now saying that we're telling the button that we want it to use our onClickListener method that we've created whenever that button's clicked. So when the button's clicked, it's going to call this onClick method that we've defined on line 27, and it's going to execute the code that we've typed in from line 28 through line 30. Now this may look complicated, but it's a standard pattern for attaching code to an event so that your method is used when the event happens. In other words, when a button is clicked in your application. So our code doesn't have to worry about checking the button. The onClick method will be called for us when the button is clicked. So that's known as event-driven programming and is actually used by most GUI frameworks, including Microsoft Windows, GNOME or KDE on Linux, and the macOS X GUI Aqua as well. So the pattern is very common. Now it can be expressed in a slightly briefer format using something called an anonymous class, and briefer still using lambdas, and we will be looking at those, but the basic pattern here is the same. Okay, so we've typed in a lot of code. Time for a big test. Does this work? Well, let's go ahead and run this application and see whether it actually works or not. So I'm going to come up here and click on the run button. I'm going to choose my device, click OK. I'm going to then tab over to it and wait for it to start. Okay, there's our application, and I'm just going to move this over a little bit so we can still see our code. Now we can click it. So we're going to click on this button now. And now we've got the button working, as you can see. So every time I'm pressing that button here in the application, this code is being executed, the variable's been incremented, and we're getting a result here. The button got tapped one time. So you notice my emulator was already running. So if you've got a slower computer, it's probably a good idea to have the emulator running in the background before you start programming, or at least when you first start up Android Studio to immediately start the emulator. It just will save you a lot of frustrating waiting, you know, perhaps minutes for the emulator to start. In my case, I've already had it running from a previous video and I've left it running, and you can see that it was fairly quick to actually build. If you click and run this again, we'll get a more instant result, but that first time I had to sort of build the application and it took a little bit longer to start. Okay, so that's the app running on the emulator. So I'm going to finish the video here now, because in the next video we need to talk about a couple of things that really need explanation, just in case you think you messed up creating the layout in the challenge. So let's talk about that in the next video.